Hello, this is Mihaela van der Schaar, and today I'm going to give a keynote talk at CompAge entitled Transforming Healthcare Through Machine Learning. I really wish that I was with you in Paris today. Unfortunately, we are all attending this conference online. However, it is especially important today, in the era of COVID, that we, the machine learning researchers, join forces with clinicians, medical personnel, policymakers, and many others to successfully fight this pandemic.
I'd like to start this talk by describing why I believe that machine learning for healthcare is different than other areas in machine learning. Of course, machine learning has accomplished wonders on well-posed problems where the notion of a solution is well-defined and the solutions are easily verifiable by a human. Examples abound in computer vision, self-driving cars, as well as robots solving complex tasks. However, I believe that healthcare is different and much more complex than all of these areas. The reason behind this is because in medicine and healthcare, the problems are not well posed and the notion of a solution is often not well defined, and the solutions are hard to verify by humans. Consider COVID-19. Let us assume that the patient has been just diagnosed with COVID-19. As he's deteriorating, we need to make a decision whether he should be admitted to the hospital. And upon admission to the hospital, as clinicians and medical personnel are taking lab tests and vital signs regularly, they are discovering that the patient is further deteriorating. At this point, a decision is to be made whether the patient needs to be admitted to the ICU, and when, and whether upon admission to the ICU, he will be ventilated and for how long. All of these are complex decisions where machine learning can potentially help decision makers make better, more informed decisions. This presents enormous challenges, but also enormous opportunities. It is our goal to build machine learning methods that can help augment human decision makers, clinicians, medical researchers, policymakers. But in order to do that successfully, to create actionable intelligence that can inform all these decision makers, we need to develop new machine learning models and techniques. We need to start a new area of research. Let me start by describing the research that we have performed in the last couple of months to fight COVID-19. I'm going to start by describing our work at the global level. If you want to see all of our research on COVID-19, I invite you to visit our website dedicated to our research in this area. The first thing that we have done in order to fight COVID-19 at the global level is the development of a policy impact predictor that is able to determine the effect of a variety of policies on deaths from COVID-19 and answer what if questions. What would have happened if a different policy would have been implemented potentially at a particular moment in time that was different than the time at which it was indeed implemented. We can do that both about the past policies, but also estimate the value of future policies in different countries. So we do that at the global level. We are looking at non-pharmaceutical interventions, or for short, NPIs. And we would like to identify what is their effects on deaths from COVID-19. We are trying to solve the problem of estimating the causal effects of NPIs applied over time on COVID-19 patients. In other words, we are going to conduct counterfactual scenario analysis. We are going to answer what if questions. Why is this important? Of course, this is very important because we can inform in this way governments and policymakers with actionable intelligence that can be very valuable to them over the next months. What is new here? Of course, a lot of research has happened on issuing predictions of COVID-19 deaths in various countries. What is different here is that we do that at the global level, so we learn across the different countries rather than one country at a time. And the second and even more important part is that we are able for the first time to answer what if questions. We are able not only to make predictions, but also to understand the effect of different policies in different countries, as well as go back and ask ourselves whether a particular intervention that was performed in a particular country at a particular moment in time was indeed the right intervention and whether we could have done better, thereby being able to learn lessons from the past. So we are learning heterogeneous NPI effects using global data from different countries. So we have an opportunity to learn across the different countries effectively at the global level. In this way, we can reduce the future of COVID-19 deaths in various countries around the world. As I mentioned before, a variety of modeling efforts have already taken place. And the CDC website in the United States contains numerous models that can issue prediction of deaths from COVID-19. But all these different modeling efforts are just issuing predictions, and are issuing predictions at one country level. Instead, as I mentioned before, we are answering, in addition to predictions, also counterfactual questions. What if? And we are doing that at the global level. How do we formalize this problem? This is very important. So we have on one hand COVID-19 deaths over time encapsulated in variable yi. Then we have country level features encapsulated in variable xi. And as you can see, this is varying over time. We have both country metadata, such as demographic information, economic information, environmental, social information, as well as public health indicators. In addition, we also have time-varying exogenous features, such as weather patterns, as well as time-varying endogenous features, such as community mobility levels. The reason I'm calling these features endogenous is because they do depend on the type of policies that are implemented. It is an effect of these policies that, for instance, the community mobility levels are changing. The different policies, the different NPI indicators are encapsulated in PI. And as you can see, different types of policies can be implemented over time at a country level. So our data set is a global data set that contains such information across a variety of countries. More precisely, as I'm going to tell you a little bit later, 170 plus countries. So we can collect such information over time from the different countries and learn at a global level from each other. In order to issue such counterfactual scenario estimation to answer what if questions, we are formalizing this within the potential outcomes framework of Neyman and Rubin. So we have a variety of interventions that can be applied at a certain moment in time, and we are going to estimate the potential outcomes of these interventions on a particular country. Of course, we are also having confounders. And in this particular work, we are going to assume there are no unobserved confounders. On the basis of this information, we are going to estimate what is the effect of different policies. We are going to answer what if questions and do counterfactual scenario analysis. As you can see here, we have the number of deaths, for instance, in a particular country up to the current time, as well as the policy decisions that were made. At the current moment in time, we can ask ourselves what would happen if different policies are applied. For instance, no lockdown or a certain level of lockdown as represented by, for instance, public events cancellation or public transport closure, or an even more stringent lockdown policy that may also include international travel restriction as well as stay-at-home orders. You can see that these different lockdown policies would result on different number of deaths over time, over the next weeks or months. And our policy impact predictor is able to estimate the effect of such policies at a particular country level. Also, this can be done for the past. We can ask ourselves, what would have happened if a particular policy was implemented, for instance, in April or in March, and what would have been the differential effect in the number of deaths if such a policy would have been implemented earlier? And you can see indeed, if you see this particular graph, where we have plotted five different countries which have the most number of COVID-19 cases. You can see here that they have implemented different types of lockdown policies at different moments in time. So we have different types of NPIs and different timing for NPIs. So we have the opportunity to learn from each other. How are we going to do that? We are going to do that by modeling the COVID-19 deaths in a particular country I using a Gaussian process. This Gaussian process is going to be a function of time and will contain a mean function and a kernel function. The mean function is going to be a compartmental model, an interpretable compartmental model, in this case, an epidemiological model, an SEIR model, as I'm going to describe in just a little bit. And the kernel function will be an exponential function. What you see here is the number of deaths in a particular country over time. And as I'm going to show in a little bit, using such a Gaussian process, we are going to estimate in a data-driven way the posterior mean and variance and be able to issue predictions over time at the country level. As I mentioned, we are going to use a Gaussian process at a particular country level, and the death forecasts are the posterior trajectory of deaths. The prior, that is going to be described in just the next slide, is the rigorous mechanistic model, the SEIR model. While the posterior is data-driven, and the posterior variance is going to enable us to identify the uncertainty in projections. And this is very important because we don't want only to issue projections, predictions about the future for the different policies, but also the uncertainty we have in these different projections and how this changes over time. So you see here in this particular graph how for different types of policies, on the basis of the data that we have so far, we can answer what if questions for these different policies. As I mentioned before, the mean function for the Gaussian process is an epidemiological model, an interpretable one, and a well-known one, the SEIR model. S stands for susceptible, E for exposed, I for infected, and R for recovered. In addition, we also have the contact rate and the number of deceased. So the number of people that are going to die from the COVID-19 pandemic. The contact rate, as you see in here, is affecting the number of people exposed, and it's going to play an important role in our model, as you are going to see in a little bit. As I mentioned before, this reproduction number that we often hear about in the news is presented in here. And this reproduction number is going to tell us how the disease is spreading over time. It is going to be influenced by the policies that are adopted. So it is these different policies that are adopted in a particular country that are going to affect the contact rate, which in turn is going to affect the reproduction number, and which will affect the number of patients that are going to die from COVID-19. So we need to adjust the different policies, and they are going to have a different effect on the number of deaths. and we want to select policies that are going to enable us to flatten the curve. How are we going to learn from other countries? We are going to learn that by adopting a joint model for all countries that will enable us to learn from the interventions of other countries. We do so using a hierarchical Bayesian model, which is a multi-layer model that will have at the higher layer an upper layer Gaussian process. And at the lower layer, as I mentioned before, another Gaussian process that is going to model the deaths at the country level. The upper layer Gaussian process is going to model the NPI variables and country level features, and they are going to be shared among all countries, enabling us hence to learn effectively across the different countries at the global level. As I mentioned before, the lower layer Gaussian process is going to be specific to a particular country and is going to model the deaths from that particular country. So the NPI effects depend on the country's features. As shown in here, as different policies are adopted, depending on the different country features, inclusively features that are varying over time, the reproduction number will be changing. So different policies are going to have different effects on the reproduction number and the number of deaths in different countries, depending on the features that these countries are having. So different looser or stricter NPIs are going to lead to different contact rates and different reproduction numbers in different countries. So we need to be able to learn from the different countries by being aware, but being aware that these different countries have different features that are going to affect the reproduction number. In order to learn effectively using this hierarchical model, we have assembled a comprehensive data set for global COVID-19 trajectories. And this data is collected from 170 plus countries. It contains COVID-19 cases, deaths as well as tests, non-pharmaceutical interventions, excess mortality, mobility statistics, weather patterns, as well as country-level metadata as collected from World Bank reports. In terms of interventions, we focus on these 13 NPIs as reported by the Oxford Government Response Tracker. The country-level metadata is also diverse and contains economic, social and demographic, environmental, and public health features. Hence, we are able to learn very effectively at a global level what matters, what type of intervention is more effective in a particular country. It may be that we are trying to impose an Italian-type lockdown in the United Kingdom, but the effects would be very different in the United Kingdom due to its unique characteristics that are differing from those in Italy. So being able to learn together by being aware, but being aware of these differences is important. How well can we learn? You can see here the accuracy of our model called PIP, Policy Impact Predictor, and how well does it do before the peak, during the peak, or after the peak. And what you can see here is the projections in United States. You can see that if the model only learns in the United States, we are doing less well than if the model is able to take information from other countries and learn at the global level. What you can see here is that the performance is very competitive with that of other models. And if we look at other countries, look at the global level, you see that our model, the PIP model, does significantly outperform other models. But again, the focus of PIP is not on just issuing predictions like these other models do. Instead, the focus is on answering what-if questions, doing counterfactual scenario analysis. So here you see data from United Kingdom. This is real data, in fact. And what we are showing here is the effect of a policy at the current moment in time for different lockdown policies and what will be the effect on the number of deaths, inclusively a second peak. Importantly, as I mentioned before, we are also going back to the past. We are able to go back to the past and ask what would have happened if a different lockdown policy would have been implemented in the UK at an earlier time. And we are able to estimate the effect of deaths in UK as well as in other countries.
So far, I have told you about our work on PEEP. However, we have done a variety of other works to fight COVID-19 at the global level, in randomized clinical trials, understanding what patients are at risk from COVID-19, etc. You can find more about our research at the global level on this website. But now I'm going to tell you how we have used machine learning to fight COVID-19 at the national level here in the UK. Very early on in this pandemic, we have joined forces with NHS Digital to develop a machine learning enabled tool for resource planning in hospitals. Our goal was to provide evidence that reliably assists the difficult decisions that clinicians and hospital managers have to make in order to save lives during this pandemic. We have used depersonalized data and used this data to forecast personalized risk for each patient, personalized patient benefit from the usage of different types of resources, identifying which treatments are needed for which patients and when, which resources are needed for each patient and when, and also forecast future demand for resources at the hospital level and national level as the pandemic evolves. More about this can be found on our website. But today I'm going to tell you about the more general setting. We are going to use machine learning to do dynamic forecasts in a variety of settings. For this, the goal is to use physiological data that is gathered in offices, clinics, or hospitals in the form of clinical findings, lab measurements, vital signs, etc., and use this data to identify disease trajectories, and on the basis of this information, make forecasts about the patient in the short run and in the long run, both in terms of disease and disease progression, but also what treatments are useful and when. So the focus is to build a model that can capture the unique characteristics of the data, and then on the basis of this, learn for a patient at hand and make dynamic forecasts that can be useful for clinicians and medical personnel.
This is, though, a very challenging problem. And the reason is we have multiple data streams and they are making different types of observations. The measurements are sparse, irregularly, yet informatively sampled. In some settings, there may be a lot of observations, in some others, very few. Some information, such as, for instance, temperature, may be much more frequently measured, while other white blood cell counts much less frequently. Also, patients may have different types of morbidities and comorbidities that may occur over time. These are multiple outcomes for which we may need to issue dynamic forecasts. And upon a particular diagnosis of a certain morbidity, we would like to understand how that particular diagnosis influences the occurrence of other morbidities in the future. Another challenge is that the true clinical state of the patient is unobserved. So, for instance, we do not know the onset of a particular disease. And also importantly, patients are very different and we deal with many possible patterns, heterogeneous phenotypes, and especially in the case patients are multimorbid, this may lead to a very diverse setting. So what we need is, we need a data-driven, accurate, and interpretable model for patient trajectories that can be used to issue dynamic forecasts. Risk scoring over time, prognosis, but also enable decision-making of clinicians and patients. The most often used methods to model disease progression are based on Markov models. And you can see that in the modeling of cancer, more generally,
or in particular, for instance, in this case, for prostate cancer, we can see that different patterns or disease are learned using Markov models or hidden Markov models. Some of these Markov models or hidden Markov models are actually having also absorbing states. For instance, the patient has died, and we are able to model trajectories in this way. Of course, hidden Markov models are very familiar to the machine learning community, and a lot of wonderful progress has been made on them over the years. More recently, hidden Markov models have also been investigated by the medical machine learning community to model physiological factors and also issue predictions over time. When we started in this area, we also started with such Markov models and hidden Markov models. But we soon discovered many challenges associated with using these models in practice. For instance, such models assume regularly sampled, fully observed processes, and this is not the case for medicine. Data is not sampled frequently and regularly. And more than that, we have informatively sampled data. Another characteristic is that they assume Markovianity, so memoryless sojourn times. However, it is well known for clinicians that it is not only the current state, but also, for instance, the duration that the patient has been in a particular state that matters in the prognosis of a patient. Also, these models assume that we have conditionally independent observations. And as I'm going to show to you next, this is not the case. Moreover, another assumption that's made is that we have supervised diagnosis and states. Yet in our case, it could be that the patient doesn't show to the doctor very frequently, so we may not observe a variety of states. So these states are not going to be annotated and are not going to be supervised. So even when we don't have observations in these different states, and certain state transitions have not been observed in the data set, we still need to be able to learn effectively. So what are the requirements? We need to build models which are truly actionable models for clinicians that provide accurate forecasts and accurate models of patient-level trajectories. They need to be learning from complex and irregularly sampled data, limited supervision. They need to consider the history, inclusively what other states the patient may have passed through and the duration in these different states. May need to learn from a variety of events, such as diagnosis of different morbidities. We need personalization because the patterns of deteriorations are diverse, and we need interpretable models. Over the past 5 years, we have went into a journey of developing better and better models to deal with this. And I'm going to take you in part of this journey because I think it's informative in showing you the challenges associated with this complex task. The first model that we have developed after the initial couple of models, which were not very effective, was called hidden absorbing semi-Markov model. And this is the technology that provided the results that I showed to you up front in this section. What we have is we have observational physiological data that is sampled irregularly. For instance, vital signs, lab tests. And on the basis of these observations, we need to learn the unobservable true state of the patient. For instance, their particular state of disease. It's challenging though, because as I mentioned before, the transition probabilities depend not only on the current state, but also sojourn times. So we need to deploy semi-Markov models. Also, as I mentioned before, not all states are supervised, are observed. Only some of them are. Some of them might be absorbing, like for instance, mortality. Some may not be, some may be though annotated, and some may not. And it is on the basis of such observable, possibly absorbing states that we need to learn. We cannot use information and annotation in all the different states. because as I mentioned before, that may not be the case. Also, we may not want to issue only predictions and dynamic forecasts for a particular risk, a risk of, for instance, mortality due to cancer, but we may want to look at dynamic forecasts of multiple competing risks, for instance, cardiac as well as cancer mortality. We learn on the basis of observational data, and this represents, for instance, in this case, a hidden absorbing semi-Markov episode. And that may include censoring. This censoring may be because the patient is admitted to the hospital, and at a particular moment in time, the patient is doing well and it has been discharged. Hence, the data is censored. We also need to be able to learn, in addition to informative censoring, on the basis of the observations made. So these are informative missingness. The times at which information was collected is informative, and we need to learn from. So we not only learn from the values of the different observations, but also from the absence and presence of information, because the sampling times are correlated, informatively correlated with the state. For instance, if a patient is doing well, we may see less observations. And when the patient is doing poorly, we may see a lot more observations. So the number of observations, the sampling rates, may be informative of the underlying state of the patient. So how are we going to model this unique characteristic of time series clinical data? We can do that by using not a Poisson point process that's uninformative, but rather a Hox point process. This enables us to model the fact that the jump intensities of this point process depend on the underlying state. And if you'd like to learn more about that and how we model that, I invite you to see an ICML paper of a few years ago. Then we can build a very versatile model. The sojourn time distribution we model as a gamma distribution. This provides us with the right flexibility such that if a patient is, for instance, their transition to the next state depends not only on the current state, but also the duration in the current state, we are going to model this flexibly using a gamma distribution. And a gamma distribution is a superset of an exponential distribution. So we may learn on the basis of the current data that, for instance, Markovianity is enough and we do not need semi-Markovianity. The semi-Markov transition functions are modeled using multinomial logistic. As I mentioned before, the sampling times at which data is acquired are modeled using a Hox point process. And the observed physiological data is modeled using a multitask Gaussian process. This provides us with a flexible, versatile model to learn from a variety of data sets, whether in the clinic, whether in the office of an attending specialized physician, or in the hospital. How can we learn the parameters of such models? We do that using a conventional process in hidden Markov models that involves a first step that determines change points. So we do a change point detection. Then associated with this, we are doing maximum likelihood estimation for the observed states, and then expectation maximization for the unobserved states. So at the first glance, it may seem that these different steps are very conventional steps in learning hidden Markov models, but not so fast. Machine learning for medicine is again challenging. So let me, before introducing some of these challenges, let me highlight the fact that what we are trying to do is to use the physiological data that we have at our disposal to infer at runtime the current state of the patient, the health and disease state of the patient. And then on the basis of that, make projections on the future, dynamic forecasts. So, for instance, on the basis of the physiological data acquired for a patient in the hospital, we infer different states the patient has passed through. Inclusively, at the current moment in time, we infer the current state the patient is in, thereby doing diagnosis, as well as we issue dynamic forecasts. When the patient will move to a next state, for how long will that patient be in the particular state, and what potential competing risks may the patient have. This is nothing else than conventional filtering and risk scoring. So diagnosis is nothing else than filtering, and risk scoring, inclusively competing risks, are issued easily in this particular framework. So all will be easy if medicine would not pose numerous challenges. We cannot use standard forward-backward algorithms to do inference. And the reason is because of various unique characteristics of medical time series data. One is that both states and transition times are hidden. So not only the state transition times are hidden, but also not only the states are hidden, but also the transition times are hidden. Then we may have intermediate states, transitions, without no observations. So we may see the patient when he was healthy, and then suddenly the patient may come back when the patient is very unhealthy. So there may be many states for which we have no observations. The observation samples may be temporally correlated. The patient may show up multiple times, and these different samples may be correlated with each other. Also, the observation samples are, as I mentioned before, irregular and possibly informatively sampled. So we need to learn in the presence of death. These all represent very unique challenges which need new technologies and new solutions in machine learning. If you are interested in learning more about that, for instance, about the hidden absorbing semi-Markov model, we invite you to read our GMLR 2017 paper. But what I'd like to highlight here is that this unique technology was developed by capitalizing on many different types of existing technologies that have been developed before. It represents a superset, an advance on top of these technologies. But all these techniques have contributed to this particular advancement. We stand on the shoulders of giants. And you may wonder, why do I need such a general model? We need such general models because we need to learn what are the unique characteristics of a particular disease and what are the unique characteristics of a particular disease evolution in one patient as opposed to another. So only when we have such a versatile model, we are able to identify unique characteristics of diseases. For instance, in this case, COVID, where we do not know how many states a patient may pass through, how fast it may deteriorate, and for how long a patient may be in a particular state. So what we need to do is we need at times to go beyond settings that we described before. Even hidden absorbing semi-Markov models may not always be effective, because the history matters. For instance, previous states, but also order of states, as well as duration of states may be important. And hidden absorbing semi-Markov models are not necessarily able to consider the entire history, non-stationary history of a patient. And this may be important. Also, it's important to capitalize on how these transitions may be influenced by the unique characteristics of a patient, for instance, their gender or their genetic information. So what we need to develop is longitudinal models that achieve two goals. One is that of accurate forecasting. We need to be able to accurately forecast individual level trajectories and make predictions of risk. Prediction of risk of mortality, of relapse, of certain morbidities appearing, comorbidities, or complications. We also, though, need to continue to issue such accurate forecasts while understanding the disease progression mechanisms, identify causal pathways, subgroups,
and phenotypes that are enabling the clinicians to debug our predictions, but also medical researchers to use such information to do clinical discovery and better understand the disease, which is a first step in truly solving a particular disease. So what we need is technologies in machine learning that are achieving both these two goals, the goal of accuracy and the goal of interpretability. And this is a challenging task because, for instance, we have black box models such as recurrent neural networks that may be very effective in issuing predictions, yet they are not very effective in issuing explanations. Conversely, we may have very interpretable and understandable methodologies such as hidden Markov models, hidden absorbing Markov models, but these ones are not maybe as efficient in issuing predictions as black box models. So just a brief review. Deep learning models are able to provide us with predictions, accurate predictions, and we have significant advances such as a technology called Retain, which provides us interpretable predictions, but uninterpretable latent structures. So the different states a patient is passing through are not interpretable. Similarly, recurrent neural networks are not able to provide us interpretable states, unlike hidden Markov models that I described before. So what type of interpretability can such models provide? Methods such as Retain or others that have followed, inclusively some from our own lab. For every patient, we can identify the important variables for predictions and for future predictions at every step based on the patient's history. So we are able to say that I'm expecting a particular event to happen, and it is on the basis of these particular observations that I made over time. Yet, we are not able to understand the unique characteristics of the patient passing through a disease progression. We do not have understandable states, and we are not able to say whether the patient has remained in this particular state or not. Hence, for the sake of phenotyping, this is not sufficient. Two patients may have very seemingly similar features and evolution of features over time, yet very different phenotypes, and hence this will lead to very different projections in the future, very different dynamic forecasts. Also, this is not enough for knowledge extraction and understanding. Often in the clinical notes, we may have annotations that may say something about the unique state of the patient, and this cannot be easily used in conjunction with methods such as the ones that I'm describing here. Conversely, as I mentioned before, we have techniques that are able to provide such interpretations, such as hidden Markov models and hidden semi-Markov models, which are learning a hidden state-based representation of the disease, which is easily understandable by clinicians, and we can use the annotations that are available in clinical records to learn from human knowledge, from clinician and medical researchers' knowledge. So how can we overcome this? How can we combine these two goals in order to issue effective methods? So in order to have both interpretability as well as high prediction, we combined in a recent methodology called attentive state-space models the powerful interpretable ability of hidden Markov models to issue interpretable, uncover interpretable probabilistic structures where states are understandable to clinicians, and then combine that with the power ability of recurrent neural networks to model state dynamics, inclusively non-stationary state dynamics, such that the entire history of a patient is effectively captured and used in order to issue accurate predictions. So we marry these two approaches to be able to build a general and versatile, effective, deep probabilistic model. We are going in this way to model the emission probabilities in a similar way as we do for hidden Markov models, and then use recurrent neural networks to model effectively the state transitions. We built, hence, an attentional state space.
And in this way, we are able to model the complex dynamics on history as non-stationary interpretable state dynamics. A difference to the current attention mechanisms, like the ones used in RETAIN, is that now we have attention, but attention on the states. So we have an attentional state space. In this way, we are able to go beyond current Markov models. The attention weights will determine the influences of past state realizations on future states. So for instance, the probability that the patient that is currently in state 6 will move to state 7 will depend on the current state 6, but also all the previous past states as learned through a recurrent neural network. So we have observations that are, for instance, vital signs, and associated with that, we are inferring an underlying hidden state, and we are also learning attention weights associated with these different states. These are the weights of the different arcs associated with the different states. So with a little bit of abuse of notation of a graphical model, I'm showing here how past states are influencing transitions to future states. So this algorithm, attentive state space model, is repeatedly updating these attention weights to focus differently on past state as time evolves. This is able to overcome shortcomings of Markov models, including semi-Markov models, because we are creating a soft version of a non-stationary variable over Markov model where the underlying dynamics change over time depending on the patient context, inclusively static values of the patient like genetic information, as well as dynamic information as captured over time. And these attentive state space models enable us to have a memory which is shaped by the patient's current context. Also, these states are now interpretable states like in the hidden Markov models. But what is maybe even more important is that we can also do true discovery, not only predictions. We are able to learn on the basis of the data that these patients with cystic fibrosis are passing through three states of disease. And associated with these different stages of disease, there are different comorbidities. The probabilities of different comorbidities emerging is changing depending on the state the patient is in. So we are able to inform now clinical researchers and medical researchers with actionable information that they can take back to the lab to better understand this disease and its progression. We can also go one step further and model multiple diseases jointly, multiple morbidities and comorbidities. Current way, state-of-the-art way in which morbidities are modeled is using networks, but these networks are static rather than dynamic and not personalized. This is a big disadvantage and this impairs discovery. These different types of networks need to be personalized and they need to be dynamic. So how do we do that? We are able to learn dynamic and personalized comorbidity networks from event data, as well as other types of data, using deep diffusion processes. And we have done that in a recent AI Stats paper. Such DDP models are able to accurately model the temporal relationship between different diseases occurring over time and how this different order of diseases, as well as duration of diseases, is going to impact the different diseases occurring over time. Also, in this way, we are able to model this as a multidimensional point process, and the intensity function is parameterized by the edges of this dynamic weighted graph. So the graph is changing over time, depending on the weights and also the unique characteristics of the particular patient. So by now, I hope that I convinced you that we are at the beginning of a revolution in healthcare, which can provide us with new understanding of diseases, relationships among diseases,
but also can provide clinicians with actionable intelligence about what treatments to use for a particular patient. Also, this enables us to allocate resources better and identify more effective pathways of care. So I hope you will join us. I would like to thank very much my brilliant PhD students and postdocs, without which this research would not be possible, and which have helped by contributing of many, many slides and insights and have helped me with this tutorial. If you would like to read more about our research, please look at our website or reach out in an email to me. And if you would like to see some of the software that has enabled some of these tools and you would like to learn from them, please follow our website and find more information here. You can find here information also about our NeuRIPS challenge, as well as our work on COVID-19. Thank you very much, and I hope to hear from you.